I know it's 5,000 people. Was it 5,000 wrong? Is there not to take the official murder of these young boys? Here we are to celebrate, bring change, and heal ourselves of what impacted on our people from Tasmania who were fighting the struggle. That means welcome to our beautiful home, the land of the two great bays. Nairn being called West Bay, Nairn being Western Shore Bay. Our country goes from the Rosen River right through down to what we know as Mrs. Promontory, our neighbours, the Wallawalung, the Woiwurrung, and Dunai Dunai. So it is all those connections. Fellow countrymen, councillors, dignitaries, artists who contribute, and the committee members that I'm part of this as a patron of these young acknowledgements. And today we are acknowledging the life of Tanminawe and Marboy Tina and the impact of the colonial policies that cut their young lives so short. I'm making this acknowledgement from two points of language. The impact of the missionaries and the colonialism and the spirit that contributed to the survival of our people and their heritage. These two positions are reflected in the history of the Briggs family, who are descendants from the great warriors and leaders from the First Peoples of Tasmania and the First Peoples of Melbourne. History is often complex and includes a multiple set of stories that we can celebrate and learn from. And what we want to share today is a sense of shared history, and this shared history links First Nations to non-Indigenous Australia. Can you all hear me? We hope the lessons from this history can provide guidance to all. My great-grandfather, John Briggs. My great-grandfather was John Briggs, the first son of Wotawotiana and the grandson of the great Tasmanian chief, Manalagana. John Briggs was born in 1820. His mother was one of the five daughters of the chief, Manalagana. His father was George Briggs, a ship's captain. John Briggs would have been the same age. John Briggs grew up, were lawless, and they controlled the controlled by the ruthless sealers, thieves, murderers. And there was no missionaries or government officials living on these remote islands. My great-grandmother Louisa Briggs was the matriarch of the Bulmurrung. She was born on the coast of South of Melbourne and went on to become the founder of one of the great Victorian. And as a young woman, she was kidnapped by the sealers and along with her mother and aunt were taken to the remote islands in the Bass Strait to work for sealers as slaves. These islands were the same lawless islands of which John Briggs was raised. And in the late 1840s, Louisa returned to her country in Melbourne. always a return to their husband, John Briggs, and her Veron Briard, Anne Briggs. Both women were married to John Briggs as an attitude which is a testament to the fact that they had grown up without the influence of the colonial officials or missionaries. Tunaminawe and Marboy, the destiny of these both, Tunaminawe, and Marboy Hina, was set by the Tasmanian colonial government and the missionary George Robertson. Denied their traditional lands and control by these missionaries, this missionary, Robertson, they had no real freedom. In 1839, Tunaminawe and Marboy Hina, along with 14 other Tasmanian Aborigines, were brought to Melbourne by George Augustus Robertson. The reason George Robertson, the new protector of the Aborigines, gave by bringing this group was to civilize the Port Phillip natives. John Batman also tried the same approach in 1835 when he brought through Sydney Black when he arrived in Melbourne. It's a thing you need to think about. The colonial tactic is to divide and rule. It was based on the assumption that all First People were the same. It failed to recognise they had very distinct cultures and heritage. And unfortunately, we still see government doing the same thing, control and manipulate the First Peoples. In 1841, Tunaminawe and Marboy Hina, with the three other Tasmanian women, set out to take revenge on those who had oppressed them and taken them from their country. The guerrilla warfare style campaign took place from the edge of the ranges of east of Melbourne right through to the edge of the southern end of Port Phillip. They raided stations after stations from Dandenong to Cape Patterson. They stole firearms and burnt down these stations. They killed the two sealers, Cook and Yanaki, wounded five settlers, burnt down numerous farmhouses and invaded captured. They were captured for 18 days. During this time, they did not harm women or children. Their revenge was purely targeted. The jury took less than 30 minutes to convict these two young men using a colonialist mindset. Today we commemorate their memory, their spirit of these two young men. The story of Tunaminawe and Marboy is about oppression of colonialism and missionaries who were their handmaids. These stories are still relevant today. Take time to reflect on the way colonialism still uses bureaucrats to control and defend our heritage. These are the three types of people. They're all First Peoples that we accepted, the missionaries, mercenaries, and insults. We still have the missionary approach by some government departments telling us what is good for us, but they are really creating jobs. So we still have mercenaries nowadays that come in different guises. They take from us but rarely contribute. The misfits abound within Aboriginal affairs. They are often people that everyone else rejects and applies to our goodwill and hospitality to survive. Now that Melbourne has acknowledged this history, we hope it's the first step towards acknowledging our story of the past, that they live stronger in us. In conclusion, I'd like to thank my own respect to Joseph Stana. It is quite an interesting memorial for many years. Joe has his support committee, have been tireless, and always shown respect and knowledge to traditional owners, and contributes with a strong sense of shared history. Thank you.